Skills 352. Study Session 5. Politics of Mexico. Introduction. This study session is to enable you to understand and to draw your attention to ongoing and interrelated challenges of Mexican politics and development. The challenges of a long tradition of authoritarian governments, long-sought economic development, and the long-standing condition of severe inequalities between the rich and the poor. Learning outcomes. When you have studied this study session, you should be able to analyze interrelated challenges of Mexican politics, prefer ways of tackling these challenges, highlight the nature, the organization, and the working of the Mexican states, and lastly, analyze policy-making process of Mexico. Historical signposts of modern Mexican states. Mexico at the crossroads. On March 23, 1994, presidential candidate Luis Donaldo Colosio finished a campaign speech in the northern border city of Tijuana. Then, as he struggled through the noisy crowd, greeting his supporters, an unknown assailant approached quickly, drew a gun, and shot Colosio in the head and torso. The assassination of Colosio, the candidate of the Institutional Revolutionary Party, RI, which had governed the country without interruption since 1929, shocked Mexico's 90 million citizens and shook its political elite deeply. Mexicans at all levels of society pondered the meaning of these violent acts, not since 1924, when a military revolt threatened to displace presidential elections, had there been such uncertainty about who would lead the government for the next 6 years. Not since 1928, when Alvaro Obregón was assassinated, had a presidential candidate met with violent death. Not since 1929, when the PRI was founded, had there been such fear that the political elite was so divided that violence, not accommodation, and compromise might be used openly to resolve disputes. The assassination came on the heels of another deeply disturbing event. On January 1, 1994, a rural rebellion in the southern state of Chiapas challenged the Mexican political system to respond to extensive evidence of iniquity and injustice. The Zapatista National Liberation Army, EZLN, named after one of the country's great revolutionary heroes, Emiliano Zapata, took over military control of four towns in the state and captured national and international attention. The EZLN demanded jobs, land, housing, food, health, education, independence, freedom, democracy, justice, and peace. The Peasants' Army also called on the government to repeal the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, which went into effect on the day the uprising started. These demands and the progress of the rebellion were immediately transmitted throughout Mexico and around the globe by domestic and international media as camera crews and reporters flocked to these remote and poverty-stricken states. The EZLN's call for an end to exploitation at the hands of voracious landowners and corrupt bosses of the PRI, as well as for social services and citizenship rights, resonated deeply throughout the country. Soon, a broad spectrum of local, regional, professional and human rights groups took up the banner of the Chiapas rebels and called on the government to open the political system to more just and democratic elections, decision-making processes and policies. By calling the army to suppress armed peasants, most of whom were Mayan Indians, the government only increased sympathy for the impoverished indigenous groups that had been marginalized from the country's development. The Chiapas Rebellion symbolized for many the reality of Mexico's political, economic, and social inequalities. For many citizens, the assassination of a presidential candidate and the rural rebellion were reasons to be concerned about the future of Mexican politics. During the 1980s and 1990s, many openly questioned the right of the PRI to continue to monopolize political power. They organized the press for fairer elections and more responsive public officials. They demanded the right of opposition parties to compete for power on an equal basis with the PRI. They argued that the president had too much power and that the PRI was riddled with corruption. So great was their disenchantment with the existing system that the PRI presidential candidate in the 1988 elections barely won, presenting the narrowest margin of victory since the party's creation. Many argued that Carlos Salinas de Gortari only won because of the widespread fraud practiced by party and government officials. Then, in 1994, Ernesto Zedillo Ponce de Leon was elected with an even narrower margin, although allegations of fraud were less insistent than they had been in 1988. Then a high-level of PRI official was assassinated on a street in Mexico City, and the man's brother was later accused of covering up leads implicating the brother of the president in the murder. By 1995, the PRI was deeply divided. Did waning PRI influence, which had contributed centrally to the long tradition of political stability in the country, presage a new era of instability, while the country struggled to build more open and democratic political institutions? The event of early 1994 raised equally puzzling questions about Mexico's economic development. Mexico was just emerging from the most profound crisis since the Depression of the 1930s. Renewed possibilities for growth were dashed by a major economic crisis at the end of the year. Beginning in the mid-1980s, the government introduced major policy changes that affected virtually every aspect of the country's economy. Reformers wanted Mexico to have a market-oriented economic system to replace one in which the state played a major role in guiding the process of development. They wanted to see the country's industry and agriculture thrive in a competitive global market. The depth and duration of the crisis and the new policies affected many people adversely. However, income fell, businesses went bankrupt, jobs were lost, and government services were cut back. Were these changes related to the outbreak of violence in Tijuana and Chiapas? Will the reformers' dreams be thwarted by an inability to adjust to a market-oriented economy? Events in Tijuana and Chiapas also drew attention to deep inequalities among social classes in the country. While modern commercial farmers prospered, the country's large peasant population faced increasing insecurity. In the cities, where 74% of the population lived, gradually improved living standards for those with steady jobs contrasted sharply with the growth of the informal sector and underground economy, in which even small children were forced to struggle daily for survival. The impressive academic credentials of the country's elites could be seen as an indictment of a system that was providing only minimal education to the poor majority, just as knowledge of those who flew to New York, Houston, and Paris for open-heart surgery called into question a public health system that struggled to provide even basic medical care to large portions of the population. Increasingly, crime, corruption, drugs, and urban violence became facts of life for all Mexicans. How would such conditions and the government's capacity to address them affect the ability to achieve economic and political reform? Thus, the assassination of a presidential candidate and a rebellion in a poor and distant region drew attention to ongoing and interrelated challenges of Mexico's development. Critical junctures. In coming to terms with these challenges, Mexicans are deeply affected by the legacies of their collective past, particularly the central formative events in the country's modern history, the Revolution of 1910. Mexico experienced the first great social revolution of the 20th century, a conflict that lasted for almost a decade and claimed the lives of as many as 2 million people. Some died in violent confrontation, but the majority lost their lives through the massive destruction, dislocation, and famine caused by the shifting and sporadic nature of the conflict. The revolution was fought by a variety of forces for a variety of reasons. Indeed, the consolidation of power that followed the violence was as important as the revolution itself. The institutions and symbols of the current political regime emerged out of these complex conflicts. Porfiriato. The roots of the revolution of 1910 are embedded in the country's long history. They lie in an era prior to the beginning of the conquest by Spanish forces under Hernan Cortes in 1519, with the rise and subsequent decline of sophisticated Amerindian civilizations. And they lie in the interaction between Spanish and indigenous cultures and in the struggle for independence that began in 1810 and lasted until independence was won in 1821, as well as in the chaotic years that followed, as issues of centralism or federalism, republic or empire, secularism or religion were debated and fought over. The most direct roots of the revolution, however, are found in the dictatorship of President Porfirio Diaz, who ruled the country from 1876 to 1911. When Diaz came into power, Mexico has been experiencing decades of political and economic turmoil that has imposed a highly centralized authoritarian system to create political order and advance economic progress. Revolution of 1910. In 1910, conflict erupted as young reformers sought to open up the political and economic systems in order to gain greater opportunities for themselves. Díaz had pledged himself to an open election for president, and in 1910, Francisco I. Madero, a landowner from the northern state of Coahuila, presented himself as a candidate. Despite being imprisoned by Díaz, Madero rapidly found himself at the front of a movement to displace dictatorship. The slogan, "Effective Suffrage, No Re-election," summed up all the reformers' goals in creating opportunities for politically ambitious people to move into positions of power. Madero was elected president in 1911, but soon proved to be a poor leader and administrator. Protests and opposition plagued his government. Within months, the new president was using the military to pull down revolts of reformers and reactionaries alike. In 1913, Madero was assassinated by leaders of the army he had called on to repress opposition. Struggles for political and military leadership continued, and political order in the country virtually collapsed. Encouraged by the weakening of the old regime and driven to desperation by increasing landlessness, villagers armed themselves and joined forces under a variety of local leaders. The most famous of these was Emiliano Zapata, who amassed a peasant army from Morelos, a state in southern Mexico. Peasant battalions swept through the countryside and grew in numbers. Women, as well as men, flocked to fight under Zapata and other revolutionary leaders. Their common goal was to reclaim the land lost to large landowners under Porfirio. Zapata's plan, the Ayala, first announced in 1911 and agreed to at a national meeting of revolutionary leaders in 1915, became the cornerstone of the radical agrarian reform that was incorporated into the Constitution of 1917. The Constitution of 1917 was forged out of this diverse and often conflicting set of interests. It established a formal set of political institutions and guaranteed a range of progressive social and economic rights to citizens, agrarian reform, social security, the right to organize in unions, a minimum wage, an 8-hour workday, profit sharing for workers, and universal secular education. In an effort to limit the power of foreign investors, the Constitution declared that only Mexican cities or the government could own lands or rights to water and other natural resources. It also contained numerous articles that severely limited the power of the Catholic Church, long a target of liberals who wanted Mexico to be a secular state. The signing of the document signaled the formal end to the revolution and an agreement among contending parties of their intention to form a new political regime. Despite such noble sentiments, violence continued as competing leaders sought to assert power and displace their rivals. Political assassinations were common through the 1920s as original skirmishes among local warlords. Zapata, Villa, and Presidents Carranza and Obregón were all assassinated. Despite this violence, power was gradually consolidated in the hands of a group of revolutionary leaders from the north of the country, known as the Sonoran Dynasty. After their home state of Sonora, these leaders were committed to a capitalist model of economic development. During the 1920s, they skillfully outmaneuvered those who wished to see a socialist economy rise from the ashes of civil war. Eventually, one of the Sonorans, Plutarco Elfas Calles, emerged as the Jefe Máximo, or the supreme leader. Elected president in 1924, Calles managed to select and dominate his presidential successors from 1929 to 1934. The consolidation of power under his control was accompanied by extreme anti-clericalism that eventually resulted in warfare between conservative leaders of the Catholic Church and their followers and the government. Although the revolution was complex and the interests contending for power in its aftermath were numerous, there were five clear results of this protracted conflict. First, the power of traditional rural landowners was undercut. In the years after the revolution, wealthy elites would again emerge in rural areas, but they would never again be so powerful in national politics nor could their power be so unchecked in local areas. Second, the power of the Catholic Church at the national level was firmly destroyed, while the church remained important at regional and local levels in many parts of the country. It no longer figured among the interests that participated openly in national political debates. Third, the power of foreign investors was severely limited. Prior to the revolution, foreign investors owned much of the country's land, as well as many of its railroads, mines, and factories. Henceforth, a clear sense of Mexican nationalism would shape economic policy making. Fourth, new political elites consolidated power and agreed to resolve conflicts through accommodation and bargaining rather than violence. And fifth, the new constitution and the PNR led the basis for a strong central government that could assert its power over the agricultural, industrial, and social development of the country. Modern Mexican governments and the country's economic development were profoundly affected by these accomplishments. The Cardenas years, between 1934 to 1940, were a period in which the bulk of the Mexican population was incorporated into the political system. Organizations of peasants, workers, middle-class groups, and the military were added to the party, and the voices of the poor majority were heard within the councils of government, reducing the risk that they would become radicalized outside them. In addition, the Cardenas years witnessed a great expansion of the role of the state, as the government set up a powerful investment bank to encourage industrialization, provide credit to agriculture, invest in infrastructure, and nationalize the petroleum industry. As with all great political leaders in pursuit of political and economic change, Cardenas' motives were mixed. As a politician, he sought a base of support among the working classes in rural and urban areas to free himself from reliance on the capitalist-oriented Sonoran dynasty. In addition, he sought to bring life to his vision of a prosperous country whose wealth was generated and shared by organized groups of peasants and workers. At another level, his actions clearly indicated his concern to control all economic groups in the interest of a larger development role for the state and a dominant position for the PRI in national politics. By encouraging extensive organization of peasants and workers into national confederations, he provided later political leaders with a set of institutions that could be used to control participation and enhance authoritarian and centralized government. Lázaro Cárdenas continued to be a national hero to Mexicans, who look back on his presidency as a period when government was clearly committed to improving the welfare of the country's poor majority. His other legacy was institutionalized pattern of political succession and presidential behavior that continued to set standards for Mexico's leaders. He campaigned extensively, even though he was not seriously challenged by other candidates, and his campaign travel took him to remote villages and regions where he listened to the demands and complaints of humble people. Cárdenas served a full six-year term and relinquished political power when his term of office was officially completed to allow the new president, Manuel Ávila Camacho, to assume fully the mantle of presidential authority. Cárdenas' conduct in office created hallowed traditions that all subsequent PRI presidents have observed. Industrialization. Although Cárdenas directed the radical reshuffling of political power in the country, leaders who succeeded him were able to use the institutions he created to counteract his reforms. This kind of political control translated into the capacity of post-Cardenas presidents to reorient the country's development away from the egalitarian social goals of the 1930s towards a development strategy in which the state actively encouraged the accumulation of wealth and investment in industrialization. Initially, industrialization created jobs and made available a wide range of basic consumer goods to Mexico's burgeoning population. Growth rates were high during the 1940s, 1950s, and 1960s, and Mexicans flocked to the cities to take advantage of the jobs created in the manufacturing and construction industries. By the 1960s, however, the policies that had encouraged industrial development were no longer generating rapid growth and could not keep pace with rapidly rising demands for jobs. The basis for Mexico's economic growth was becoming weaker, not stronger, with the passage of time. The country's economy was in deep crisis by the mid-1970s. In fact, the crisis helped two presidents, Miguel de la Madrid, 1982 to 1988, and Carlos Salinas, 1988 to 1994, help them introduce the first major reversal of the country's development strategy since the 1940s. New policies were put in place to limit the government's role in the economy and to make it easier for Mexican producers to export their goods. This period clearly marked the beginning of a new effort to become more important in international economic affairs. In signing NAFTA, which commits Mexico, the United States, and Canada to eliminating trade barriers among them, Mexico's policymakers signaled the extent to which they envisioned the future prosperity of their country as tied to that of other states in the region. Efforts to increase trade and investment to Latin America, European and Asian countries also emphasized Mexico's new commitment to competitiveness in the global economy. The economic reforms of the 1980s and the 1990s were a turning point for the country's development, even though they left unresolved issues of democratic and social reform, and meant that Mexico's future development would be closely tied to conditions in the international economy. A major economic crisis at the end of 1994, in which billions of dollars of foreign investment fled the country, was indicative of this new international vulnerability. Nationalism and national identity. The myth, legends, symbols, and realities of the Porfirio, the revolution of 1910, the struggles of Canada's years, and the process of industrialization are deeply embedded in the images that Mexicans have of themselves as a nation. In addition, national interpretations of the pre-Hispanic past, the conquest of indigenous people by Spanish colonizers, and the struggle for independence are important in the widely shared belief that Mexico is a unique and special nation. The moral arts that flourished in the years after the revolution reflects the ways in which historical experiences have been claimed as part of the collective identity that defines Mexicans. Mexico has frequently been on the losing end of its relationship with the U.S. Poor Mexico, Porfirio Diaz reported to have said, so far from God and so close to the United States. A peace treaty in 1848 ended a war with the United States that erupted when the United States annexed Texas, which had once belonged to Mexico. Mexico lost the war and half its territory to the United States. U.S. troops occupied Mexico City in 1847. Mexicans from widely diverse backgrounds and status share a deep sense of nationalism based on these historical experiences and symbols. Mexicans from widely diverse backgrounds and status share a deep sense of nationalism based on these historical experiences and symbols. But Mexicans, like citizens of many other countries, are also critical of their country's past and present. They are well aware that the noble goals of revolution, democracy, social justice, and nationalism have been sacrificed to political order and the economic advancement of some at the expense of many others. Their sense of national uniqueness and pride coexists with deep cynicism about a system in which electoral results are predetermined and social class divisions are extensive. In the 1980s, concerns about the widening gap between national ideology and national realities increased the willingness of many Mexicans to organize in opposition to the PRI-dominated system. They did so, however, out of a desire to see their country fulfill its historical commitment, not because they had lost their sense of national identity. Mexicans share a deep sense of national identity, but they also recognize distinctions based on their affiliations to region, class, and special interests. They will, for example, identify themselves as Northerners or Southerners, city folk or villagers, Yucatecans or Tamaulipans, just as the people in the United States identify with these distinct regions of the country, types of lifestyles, and particular states. Mexico's middle class is large by developing country standards, and increasingly, many identify themselves with this label. The revolutionary heritage of the country also means that many identify themselves proudly as workers or peasants. The same revolutionary heritage discourages people from openly claiming title to aristocratic or highly elite backgrounds, but there is little question that such distinctions are important socially. Traditionally, political activity has been organized around class identities, even within the PRI. Currently, just as in other countries, groups based on common values or shared concerns such as community, the environment, gender, or specific economic and political issues are becoming more prevalent. None of these identities threatens the overall sense of national belongingness, however. Another ingredient in the collective identity of Mexicans is less easily incorporated into their sense of historical uniqueness. In their aspirations for the future of their country, Mexicans increasingly share the image of a prosperous and modern population living in cities full of skyscrapers and enjoying the latest communication technologies, consumer fashions, and musical fads. They desire to live in a country that is important and powerful in international debates, that benefits from international trade, that is open and democratic, and that is part of a world of states. These images portray a nation that resembles the industrialized countries of North America and Western Europe. Can this image be widely shared without destroying so much that has traditionally made Mexicans believe they have a unique heritage and culture? Given these internal and external pressures, will Mexico in the future look significantly different from Mexico in the past? How much will the pressures for change and the potential loss of national identity affect the nature of the political system? It is, of course, difficult to predict what particular changes will occur in Mexico in the coming decade or two. Indeed, at the outset of the 1980s, few people in the world could have predicted the extensive economic policy reforms and pressures for democracy that Mexico faced in that decade. Economic and political crises catapulted the country towards economic policies and compromises with opponents of PRI that took most people by surprise. Constitution of the states. According to the supreme law of the land, the Constitution of 1917, Mexico's political institutions resemble those of the United States. There are three branches of government, and a set of checks and balances limits the power of each. The Congress is composed of a Senate and a Chamber of Deputies. 128 senators are elected, four from each of the country's 31 states, and an additional four from the federal district, that is the capital. 500 deputies are elected from 300 electoral districts, 300 by simple majority votes, and 200 by proportional representation. The states and local governments are also elected. The president, governors, and senators are elected for 6 years, and deputies and municipal officials are elected for 3. In practice, the Mexican system is very different from that of the United States. The Constitution is a very long document, especially when compared to that of the United States. It lays out the structure of government and guarantees a wide range of human rights, including familiar ones, such as freedom of speech and protection of the law, but also economic and social rights, such as the right to a job and the right to health care. The political system is highly centralized and presidentialist, a moderate authoritarian system governed by a civilian elite that shares membership in a dominant party and commitment to political stability and economic development, although the system has made a series of pragmatic adjustments to pressure for greater democracy and electoral honesty. It remains far from the electoral democracy familiar to the U.S. citizens. Its policy-making processes are also very distinct from those in the United States, even though the constitutional arrangement of power is superficially similar. The executive. The political sun rises and sets every 6 years on the presidency. This statement by an observer of Mexican politics suggests the importance of the presidency to the political system. The Mexican presidency is a central institution in a centralized system of governance and policymaking. The president selects his successor, appoints officials to all positions of power in the government and the PRI, and often names the PRI candidates who in the past almost automatically won elections as governors, senators, deputies, and local officials. The president sets the broad outlines of policy for the administration and has numerous resources to ensure that those policy preferences are adopted. Until the mid-1970s, Mexican presidents were considered above criticism in national politics and revered as symbols of national progress and well-being. While economic and political events of the 1980s and 1990s diminished the prestige of incumbent presidents, the extent of their power remains impressive. In fact, some have argued that Mexican presidents are little short of dictators during their 6 years in office. Mexican presidents have a set of formal power that allows them to initiate legislature, lead in foreign policy, create government agencies, make policy by decree or through administrative regulation and procedures, and appoint a wide range of public officials. More importantly, informal power provides them with the capacity to centralize control in the executive, that is, the president is head of the PRI, manager of vast patronage machinery for fulfilling positions at all levels of government and the party, initiator of legislation and policies that are routinely approved by the Congress, and the designator of his own successor. His preferences determine who will rise and fall in political fortune and how government resources will be spent. When the president makes his first State of the Nation address, Mexicans listen avidly to learn what's going to happen for the next 6 years, as he tells them what to believe in and how to behave, as one observer of Mexican politics stated. In the last year of an administration, a sitting president selects his own successor through a process known as death tape, that is, unveiling. This continues to be a mysterious process. It is generally assumed that the president consults with leaders of businesses and labor and with top-level chiefs in the PRI, as well as with his own close advisors. But there is no requirement that he do so and no evidence that it is regularly done. Among the factors that political commentators believe are considered in the selection are pressures to accommodate important political interests and the president's desire to see his own policy preferences maintained. Once the president has made his choice, it is normally announced by the leadership of the PRI, often by the head of the CTM. Immediately, the candidate is acclaimed as the unanimous and most popular choice by all sectors of the party and by politically ambitious officials all over the country. The PRI presidential candidate has almost always been a member of the outgoing president's cabinet. In past years, several have been Minister of the Interior, the person responsible for maintaining internal law and order. This was true of Miguel Alemán, 1946 to 1952, Adolf Ruiz Cortines, 1952 to 1958, Gustavo Díaz Ordaz, 1964 to 1970, and Luis Echeverria, 1970 to 1976. With the expansion of government's role in economic development, candidates in the 1970s and 1980s were selected from the ministries that managed the economy. José López Portillo, 1976 to 1982, had been Minister of Finance, and Miguel de la Madrid, 1982 to 1988, and Carlos Salinas, 1988 to 1994, had served as Minister of Budgeting and Planning prior to being selected as candidate. The selection of Luis Donaldo Colosio, who had been Minister of Social Development and Welfare, was thought by political observers to signal renewed concern with problems of social development. When Colosio was assassinated, the selection of Ernesto Zedillo, who had first been Minister of Budgeting and Planning and then Minister of Education, was interpreted as an ongoing concern with social problems of the country and as an effort to maintain the policies of economic liberalization that Salinas had introduced. Those selected to run for president under the banner of the PRI have all had long public careers, until Luis Echeverria was selected in 1969. Candidates had usually held elective positions, often as state governors, as well as positions within the PRI and the government. Echeverria and his successors, however, never held elective positions. In addition, party activism became much less important as a criterion for high-level office. Recent presidents have gained party credentials by serving as directors of the PRI's policy think tank or as campaign managers, rather than by working their way up from the ranks of the party. They were assigned these activities after they had become prominent enough to be among the handful of the hopefuls for the death tape. Luis Colosio had been the campaign manager for Carlos Salinas. He was then selected to head the party prior to being brought into the cabinet. Ernesto Zedillo never held any elective or important party positions until he was chosen as campaign director for Colosio. Moving away from the tradition of extensive experience in the party and regional politics, candidates since the mid-1970s have spent more of their careers in Mexico City and have tended to be trained in economics and public management rather than traditional field of law. Presidents since Lopez Portillo have had postgraduate training at elite institutions in the United States. Miguel de la Madrid held a master's degree in public administration from Harvard. Carlos Salinas received a PhD in political economy and government from Harvard. Luis Colosio studied for a PhD in economics from the University of Pennsylvania. And Ernesto Zedillo had a PhD in economics from Yale. Some have argued that because of their tendency to come from more urban and elite backgrounds, recent presidents have lost touch with the masses and with the traditional politicians of the PRI, who have their roots in regional, labor, or rural politics. By the 1980s, a topic of great debate in political circles was the extent to which a divide between politicals and technicals, that is, the technocrats, had emerged within the national political elite. Among the old guard of the PRI, there was open skepticism about the ability of young technocrats like Carlos Salinas and Ernesto Zedillo to manage political conditions in the country. During the presidential campaign of 1994, considerable efforts were made to stress the more humble beginnings of Colosio and Zedillo and the fact that they had to work hard to get an education. Once selected as the official candidate, the future president must campaign widely and exhaustively, sometimes for as long as a year prior to the August elections. He is expected to put on rousing campaign appearances, making speeches that remind voters of the heroic traditions of the revolution and the PRI's agenda for bringing social and economic justice to the country. In a tradition set by Lázaro Cárdenas, he must take time to listen to the grievances of ordinary citizens in remote villages and dusty urban squatter settlements. He is expected to pay particular attention to the poor and marginalized, to whom he will promise assistance once elected. This kind of campaigning helps elevate the president to the level of a national symbol of unity and promise, a person who, though elected as a supreme leader, is able to speak with common people and share their concerns, dreams, and aspirations. In his travels, the candidate must also meet extensively with local and regional politicians and PRI operatives and work to strengthen the PRI networks throughout the country. Once elected, the president moves quickly to name a cabinet. Generally, he selects as his closest advisors those with whom he has worked over the years as he has risen to political prominence. He may also use cabinet posts to make certain he has a broad coalition of support. In this regard, he may appoint people with close ties to the labor movement or to business interests or to some of the regional strongholds of the party. Under Carlos Salinas, for example, the president's closest advisors assume leadership of important economic ministries such as finance, industry and commerce, and planning and budgeting. Ministries that were less central to his policy concerns, such as interior, labor, and transportation and communication, were awarded to those who had strong links to the old guard of the PRI, often to those who had strong skills in negotiating political deals and resolving conflicts within the party. During his administration, cabinet changes signaled the emergence of new president's priorities when Luis Colosio, a very close ally of President Salinas, was moved to the Ministry of Education. Most took this as a signal that education would be the next sector to be reformed by the Salinas technocrats. The president also selects the head of the party and head of important state-owned companies, such as the National Electricity Board and Pemex, the petroleum company. He has numerous appointments to fill high-level positions in the office of the president, which allows him to provide policy direction and keep tabs on what is occurring throughout the government and the party. These appointments help the president build a team of like-minded officials with the government and ensure that those who hold the most important positions are personally loyal to him. In turn, high-level appointees have numerous jobs that they fill in the organizations. Like the president, they use this patronage power to put together personally loyal teams of officials whose career advancement is tied to their own political faith. These officials, in turn, build their own teams, and so on, down through middle levels in the bureaucracy. The initiation of each new administration is therefore characterized by extensive turnover of positions, although Many of the newly appointed officials served in other positions in prior administrations. This giant patronage system has the potential to be extremely inefficient, and indeed, little happens in government in the year prior to an election as officials bide their time or jockey for positions in the next administration or in the year following an election as newly appointed officials learn the ropes and assemble their own teams. Nevertheless, when a president has set clear goals and expects high performance from his personally chosen officials, these people in turn must expect good performance from their staffs if they are to produce for the president. In many situations, then, the patronage system results in the potential for increased presidential leadership and effective performance, at least at high levels in government, as officials seek to do well by their superiors and therefore advance their careers. Many middle and high-level officials hope that their performance will be noticed by their minister, especially if that person has the potential to be selected as the PRI's presidential candidate. If this should happen, they could expect to be appointed to a higher-level office in the next administration. Once the newly appointed officials are in office, the president is in a position to set and carry out important policy measures, together with the bureaucracy. The president is the focal point of all policy formulation and political management. The legislature has always had a PRI majority and has acted as a rubber stamp on presidentially sponsored legislature. In 1988, the PRI lost enough seats in the Chamber of Deputies that it no longer had the two-thirds majority needed to pass amendments to the Constitution. Carlos Salinas, therefore, had to wait until the midterm elections of 1991 returned this majority before he introduced amendments that made significant changes in such important areas as right to lands in rural areas and church-state relations. Mexican presidents, though powerful, are not omnipotent. They must, for example, abide by a deeply held constitutional norm fully adhered to since 1940, to step down at the end of their term, and they must honor the political norm to step out of the political limelight to allow the successor to assume full presidential leadership. In addition, several factors tend to limit the extent of presidential discretion. Mexican presidents are always creatures of the system, selected because they have proved themselves adept at understanding and playing by the rules of the existing system. Through their careers in politics or government, they have become familiar with the range of interest groups in the country and have demonstrated a willingness to compromise on policy and political issues so that these interests do not unduly challenge the government. They have also proved themselves to be skillful in the fierce bureaucratic policies that surround career advancements and in guessing about who the next candidate for president is likely to be. In addition, presidents must demonstrate their loyalty to the myth and the symbols of Mexican nationalism, such as the indigenous roots of much of his culture, the agrarian origins of the revolution, commitment to social justice, and sovereignty in international affairs. One of the most effective constraints on presidential power is the limited ability to ensure that policies are actually implemented. At times, policies are not implemented because public officials at lower levels in government disagree with the policies or make deals with affected interests so they can benefit personally. This is the case, for example, with taxes that remain uncollected because individuals or corporations bribe officials to overlook them. In other cases, lower level officials may lack the capacity or skills to implement some policies, such as those directed towards improving education or rural development services. For whatever reasons, Mexican presidents cannot always deliver on their intentions. Traditionally, they have been above criticism when this has occurred because of the willingness of Mexican citizens to blame lower-level officials for such slippage. However, exempting the president from responsibility for what occurs and what does not occur during his watch became much less common in the 1980s and 1990s. Bureaucracy. Mexico's executive branch is large and powerful. Almost 1.5 million people work in the federal bureaucracy, most of them in Mexico City. An additional 1 million work in the national education system, and yet another 1 million work for the large number of state-owned industries and semi-autonomous agencies of the government. State and local governments employ over 600,000 people. Pay scales are usually low, and in the past, the number of people filling lower-level positions, such as drivers and messengers, and clerical and maintenance jobs, far exceeded demands for them. In the 1980s, austerity measures cut down on some of their overstaffing. Officials at lower levels in the bureaucracy are unionized and protected by legislation that gives them job security and a range of benefits. At middle and upper levels, most officials are called confidence employees. That is, they serve as long as their bosses have confidence in them. These are the officials who are personally appointed by their superiors at the outset of an administration. Their modest salaries are compensated for by the prospect of career mobility and by the significant power that they can have over the course of public events. For aspiring young professionals, a career in government is often very attractive because of the challenge of dealing with important problems on a daily basis and being part of the process of finding solutions. Some employees also benefit from opportunities to take bribes or use insider information to promote private business deals. From the 1980s on, the Mexican government became famous for the large number of young technocrats who were attracted to public office, many of them trained in economics and public policy at major U.S. universities. In fact, 59% held degrees in economics, and many of them had advanced degrees from universities such as MIT, Yale, the University of California at Berkeley, and the University of Pennsylvania, Stanford, and Harvard. These officials filled their ministries with young and well-trained appointees, further reinforcing the technocratic image of this administration. Echoing some of the concerns about the political inexperience of recent presidents, such officials were criticized for being remote from the life experiences of the significant number of people living below the poverty line and the large number who do not have access to decent public services or normal protection of the law. Some confirmation of this perspective came in the wake of the Chiapas Rebellion, when high-level officials seemed caught off guard by the demands of those participating in the rebellion. Policy initiative is routinely taken by the central ministries in direct response to the president's policy priorities. Ministries headed by the most likely presidential candidates and staffed by people closest to the president are the ones that respond with greatest zeal to the president's lead. Ministries that have been awarded to groups or interests that are important to the PRI's coalition are more likely to be less activist in following presidential preferences. If this have any negative consequence for those interests, thus, for example, during the Salinas administration, many ministries were called upon to eliminate a wide range of the regulatory functions they had traditionally performed. Some ministries were slow to respond, however, because the regulation threatened the convenient relationships they have developed with the industries they were charged with regulating and eliminated many opportunities for collecting bribes. The military. Mexico is one of only a few countries in the developing world that have successfully depoliticized the military. Much of the credit for this progress belongs to Plutarco Calles, Lázaro Cárdenas, and subsequent presidents who introduced mechanisms to rotate regional commands among the military brass so that none could build up regional bases of power. In addition, post-revolutionary leaders made an implicit bargain with the military leaders by providing them with opportunities to engage in businesses so that they do not look to political power as a way of gaining economic power. Salaries and benefits for the military have been kept at the adequate levels to limit possibilities that such conditions could become politicized. After 1946, the military, which originally formed one of the pillars of the PRI, no longer had institutional representation within the party and became even more marginalized from the centers of power. Since that time, the military has kept poor, small, and subordinate to civilians' leadership. Nevertheless, the military has from time to time been called in to deal with situations of domestic unrest in rural areas in the 1960s, in Mexico City, and other urban areas to repress student protest movements in 1968. In 1988, in the arrest of a powerful labor leader, in 1989, to break a labor strike, in 1990, to deal with protests over electoral fraud, and most recently, in Chiapas in 1994. The military was also called in to deal with the aftermath of the earthquake in Mexico City in 1995. But his poor ability to respond to the emergency and his lack of capacity to assist citizens in need did little to enhance his already low esteem in the eyes of the public. The military has also been heavily involved in efforts to manage drug trafficking in recent years, and rumors abound about deals struck between military officials and drug barons. How the institution really operates and the extent to which such rumors reflect reality, however, remain one of the great mysteries of modern Mexico. When the military is called in to resolve domestic conflicts, some observers of Mexican politics become concerned that the institution is becoming politicized and may begin to play a larger role in political and policy decision making. From time to time, rumors of preparations for a coup are heard, as during financial panics in the 1980s and in the aftermath of the assassination of candidate Colosio. Thus far, however, such fears have not been realized, and many believe that as long as civilian administrations are able to maintain the country's tradition of stability, the military will not intervene directly in politics. Mexican politics, for all its authoritarianism and abuses of power, continues to be firmly civilian. Policy making process. This session outlines a policy process that is fully dominated by Mexico's president. In fact, the Mexican system is enormously dependent on the quality of his leadership and presidential understanding of how economic and social policies can affect the development of the country. Broad changes in the scope and direction of policies confirmed to presidential administrations, because each president has considerable capacity to introduce such changes. In selecting their successors, of course, presidents try to ensure that the candidates agree with and will continue their policy initiatives. But there is no assurance that this will happen. New presidents often wish to distance themselves from their predecessors and to ensure their own place in history by initiating new policies and development goals. In a rare example of the tensions that occur in the transition from one session to the next, in early 1995, the administration of Ernesto Zedillo openly blamed the outgoing administration of Carlos Salinas for mismanaging economic policy. As indicated throughout this study session, the sexenio is an extremely important factor of political life in Mexico, calibrating the basic rhythm of public life. New presidents introduce extensive change in positions within the government and the PRL. They are able to bring in their people, who in turn build teams of their people within ministries, agencies, and party networks. This generally provides the president with a group of high and middle level officials who share general orientation towards public policy and who are highly motivated to carry out his goals. They also believe that in doing so, they enhance their own opportunities for upward political mobility in the future. In such a context, it is possible to introduce changes in public policies every 6 years. Of course, under most conditions, the extent of change is limited by the resources the government has and by elite support for such changes. Presidential skills in negotiating, managing oppositions, using the media to acquire public support, and maneuvering within the bureaucracy can be important for ensuring that the presidential vision is fully endorsed. Under extraordinary conditions, such as the deep and sustained economic and political crisis faced by Carlos Salinas, it is even possible to introduce major reversals in national development strategies. The first months of Ernesto Zedillo's administration were marked by considerable conflicts with disaffected elements in the PRI, and many questioned the president's political skills and ability to build support for his agenda. Significant limits on presidential power also occur when policy is being implemented. In fact, in areas as diverse as the regulation of working conditions, anti-pollution laws, tax collection, election monitoring, and provision of basic health care in remote rural areas, Mexico often has extremely advanced legislature on the books. Even country familiarity with factory conditions, pollution in Mexico City, tax evasion, election fraud, and poor health care suggests that in many cases, legislature remains on the books rather than being translated into practice. Because of this tendency, it is important to treat many government claims about its accomplishment with some skepticism. There are frequently large gaps between what is announced as policy and what is accomplished in fact. Legislature. For almost 60 years, Mexico's two-chamber legislature was fully dominated by the PRI. Because of the overwhelming presence of this political party, opposition to presidential initiatives was rarely heard, to the extent that representatives did not agree with policies they were asked to rubber stamp. They counted on the fact that policy implementation would be flexible and would allow for after-the-fact bending of the rules or disregard of measures that were harmful to important interests. As we have seen, almost total control of the legislature of the PRI was destroyed, at least temporarily, in 1988. The growing strength of opposition parties, combined with legislature that provided for greater minority representations in the Congress, led to the election of 240 opposition deputies that year. After that, when presidential legislation was sent to the chamber, real debates about issues often ensued, and the opposition challenged the tradition of legislative passivity in the face of presidential initiatives. Because the Salinas administration was engaged in introducing major policy reforms, some of which required constitutional amendments in order to be implemented, some initiatives were not brought to Congress and the reform process was shelved. In other cases, the president pursued policy initiatives through decree laws and administrative measures rather than through the legislature, where they might be questioned even when they would certainly be approved by the PRI delegates. The two-third PRI majority was returned in 1991 amid allegations of significant voter fraud, and presidentialism was reasserted. Nevertheless, the strong presence of opposition parties encouraged the legislature to become more of a forum for debate than it had been traditionally, and PRI delegates were challenged to defend legislative initiatives. The 1994 elections returned a clear PRI majority of 300 deputies and 64 senators. Opposition parties will be heard, but they will not be able to stop firm presidential leadership in legislature unless the PRI becomes significantly fragmented and its legislators cease to vote as a bloc. The judiciary. Like all other political institutions in Mexico, the judiciary is politically, though not constitutionally, subordinate in the presidentialist system. On most issues, the court rules on the basis of established laws. They can occasionally slow the actions of government by issuing a writ of protection, that is an amparo, to individuals who claim that their rights are being violated by specific government actions. Although such writs are issued from time to time, they are not generally used to restrain presidential power or intentions. On almost all issues in which the power of government or presidential interests are at stake, the courts can be counted on to rule on the side of the government. In this sense, the courts are not independent voices within the political system. Even though the principle of judicial review is accepted, they are instead part of a structure of power that makes it difficult for opposition voices to be heard or protected. With increasing interest in human rights issues in recent years, the courts are under added pressure from the media and citizens group to play a stronger role in protecting basic freedoms. Concern about confidence in the legal system figured in the presidential campaign in 1994, when the PRI candidate argued that citizens do not feel that the authorities are on their side. There are cases of police and law enforcement agencies' corruption almost every day. Study session summary. In this study session, we consider the pace and dimensions of political change in the future. It is important to remember that Mexico has a long tradition of relatively strong institutions. It is not a country that will easily slip into sustained political instability. In this regard, it is a country that is significantly different from many others in the developing world. Also, we noted that Mexico has a strong political system that has incorporated a wide range of interests, a weak tradition of military involvement in politics, and a strong sense of national identity. These are among the factors that need to be considered in predicting the political consequences of democratization, economic integration, and greater social equality. We also noted that policy process in Mexico clearly indicates that the government, not the PRI, is the principal source of policy leadership. Of course, the president is elected as a standard bearer of the PRI, but he has traditionally dominated the party from the time. He sets the party platform for the elections to the time he selects the head of the party. After taking office to the time he chooses his successor, as he gets ready to step down from power. End of study session 5. Thank you.